one more panel before the lunch, and that will be two papers that will be given. These are on the topic of blue carbon and practical approaches to emissions offsetting. I'd like to invite Erik Mink to the podium. Erik will be giving our first paper. He's a senior consultant in European affairs and has a long and distinguished career of consulting in this the particular sector, and he's going to be talking about the blue carbon concept. So thank you, Erik. And Kevin will give you the 2-minute warning. The green button moves it forward.
Thank you, Chair. So I've been asked to say a few words on the role of blue carbon in carbon management, carbon sequestration in coastal areas. And it's a topic that some of you know very well and others not at all. So I'll talk a little bit about the concept. Blue carbon is the carbon that is stored in the ocean and in coastal biotopes, ocean biotopes and coastal biotopes. So you would probably think that the ocean takes the largest part of that, but it has been realized some 30 years ago that the coastal biotopes, in particular mangroves, wetlands, marshlands, and seagrass, are net absorbers of carbon and play a major role in storing carbon in the total context of the oceans. And well, I didn't look for the nicest pictures, but the mangroves, the marshlands, and the seagrass beds are important ecosystems in the context of the marine coast, because they are rich in ecosystem services. Obviously, carbon we'll discuss, but there are many other important roles for these ecosystems, these biotopes. For example, in coastal protection, they play also an important role. Mangroves are nurseries for fish. There are lots of additional benefits for these biotopes, and they have been destroyed at a large scale. So we'll talk a little bit about the implications. So I show you the concept of blue carbon has in fact been strongly promoted by Duke University, the Nicholas Institute, and their partners, but it is spreading, and it's a very interesting concept. So I show you two traditional slides that show average values and that illustrate why it's important. The first one talks about the absorption rates, the burial rates of carbon between land biotopes and coastal biotopes. Also on the left-hand side, you see tropical forest, temperate forest. They all have about the same amount of carbon per unit area stored. And on the right-hand side, you see the same for the blue carbon biotopes, the salt marshes, mangroves, and seagrass. And that's on the unit area. Sorry, this, the first one is the burial rate, and the second one is the stored rate, the amount of carbon that is stored in these the same biotopes, and the difference. Sorry, seagrass, salt marsh, mangroves, and the two varieties of the mangroves, and the difference between blue and green is the amount stored in the soil underneath. That is the carbon that has been sequestered over many, many years, sometimes centuries. And in particular for mangroves, it has been found that that these layers that are carbon-rich can be 10 meters thick and contain an enormous amount of carbon. And the green is the amount of carbon stored in the living material. And underneath you see the same graph for tropical forest. So in both cases, it's clear that the efficiency, if you like, the contribution of the blue carbon biotopes per unit area is higher than for land-based sources. And they are net carbon sequestration biotopes. So they take up carbon and they store carbon for long long periods. So they have to be cherished. That is basically the message, but they can also be used and play a role in the in coastal management and in the development of ports and marinas. So first a little bit about the process itself. Carbon storage is the effect of, in the end, taking up CO2 from the atmosphere, digesting it by the trees, and then it's dispersed into several sources. Now, from this graph, I'm not going to discuss that in detail. The point is that it's a very complex process, and it's also very, very complex to quantify, because there are so many different parts and different streams of carbon that have to be accounted for, that the actual carbon quantity that is sequestered is difficult to measure. And that's probably why it took took so long before it was realized that these biotopes are very important in taking up carbon and into in protecting. Now, it can nevertheless be done. The average values have been found, and average values vary obviously per climate zone, and per per type of mangrove, per size and variety. Nevertheless, if we want to use this in actual management of coastal biotopes and in port development, then we need to be able to quantify it. So we have looked in the context of the European Dredging Association, we've looked a little bit at the quantification side, and this table provides you with average values. You'll find it back in the conference pack, and what it shows is that the seagrass the dominant contribution is really the amount of carbon stored. For salt marsh, it's typically the same thing. The amount of carbon in the biotope, in the living material, is limited. In mangroves, it's different. In mangroves, it's about equal. The amount of carbon stored, which is already significant, can be about equal to what's in the living biomass. And in the last column you see the totals. So in other words, the mangroves are the most effective contributors per unit area. The salt marsh is in the middle and the seagrass is underneath. So what do these kind of figures mean? If we produce CO2 by emissions of otherwise, but we're looking primarily at emissions. To compensate for 10 tons of CO2, a carbon sink of 1 hectare is needed for mangroves, 1.5 for salt marsh, and 2 hectare for seagrass. So that gives a rough basis for quantification and to realize what we're talking about. Now, how do we go about it? The biotopes in particular, the mangroves, but salt marsh as well, has been destroyed at an alarming scale over the last basically a century, but in particular since the Second World War. It has gone at an enormous speed, and there are years that 2% of the mangrove area is destroyed around the world through urbanization effects. So the obviously the importance of this the carbon stored is such that that it should be avoided if we can in the future. The conservation is really the first objective. Now conservation is not not a responsibility of the industry in the first place. That's clear. It's a national responsibility planning, but it has to be kept in mind that we really should think about the importance of conservation of blue carbon biotopes. The second objective is more relevant for the industry. It's the possibility for compensation of blue carbon area lost. So in the text, I have included a simplified calculated example of a marina that's being built next to a mangrove area and what that represents in terms of CO2 and what can be done about it. So the suggestion is that in such a case where if you want to build a marina in an area that was previously a mangrove forest, you take away carbon-rich soil, so that should not be exposed to the atmosphere. So the way to go about it is the working with nature principle, or the engineering with nature principle, that this material could be used for building, for example, an island before the coast that protects has a role in protecting the coast, and where the mangroves can be replanted. That's the idea of compensation. And if that's being done in a smart way, it's absolutely feasible in many places. Of course, one has to realize that if you do that, the stored carbon is maintained, is kept, but the carbon uptake capacity is reduced, at least for the time being, because new plants have to grow. Third possibility is mitigation or offset. If a contractor or a port, for that matter, decides to compensate for CO2 emissions by buying certificates, that's really what it amounts to, the market. But if you buy a certificate, that has to come from somewhere. So there are possibilities to provide certificates by rebuilding mangrove forest. My personal experience on that point is in West Africa. There has been a large drought, and many of the mangroves along the coast died, but the area is still there, so it's relatively easy to replant these mangroves. And we did some calculation again in connection with the dredging industry, and it makes you laugh, but the conclusion was that if we want to compensate or to offset all the emissions of the European dredging fleet, we would have to replant a mangrove area of the size of Luxembourg. So we are talking about large effects and large problems. But it's possible to create also the market for offsets and certificates, but it's a very difficult issue for the industry. We suggested that maybe there could be a common initiative, but if you talk to contractors, the answer is, but that affects our competition. We are not going to do that alone. So compensation is the most direct aspect for the industry. It needs to be considered in the design stage, as has been said. One has to create at least the equivalent surface area of lost biotopes. It takes time before it's fully effective, and it adds cost to a project. That's undeniable. In some cases, you can make savings, but in most cases, it's a 10 to 50% cost increase of the project itself. We did some in the paper. You'll find a small calculation on the what happens if you account for the cost of CO2, and then in the example that amounts to about 2.5% if you take a CO2 price per ton of 50 euros per ton, But that's just an example. But these are order of magnitudes indications to show that we're not talking about small things. But it is conceivable that the industry takes initiatives to deal with emissions and try to work towards carbon neutrality. On the offsets, if you further remark, the system is to create a market, to create certificates. The current conditions cost between $20 to $50 per ton, and the cost should be seen as the price to pay for climate change, sea level rise. So it has to be compared to the social cost of not doing it. And project offsets add some 2 to 5% to the dredging cost is our estimate. And the conclusion comes, the chair is already ready to intervene. Blue carbon biotopes are very important and should not be ignored. Their importance is being realized more and more, and we should do, the construction industry and the port industry should do as much as they can do to conserve and to compensate for a loss of these biotopes. And the cost impact is the price to pay for climate change. Thank you.